Okay, so good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much for joining Nelmini and myself today with the wonderful host, Naomi, giving us the space to talk about intersectionality and the culturally and linguistically diverse communities. My name is Manal Shehab. I am a WIRE team leader. I'm a freelance counsellor in the community, Muslim community, predominantly in the north, and I also work with SHARC Family Drug Help as a peer support and psychoeducation support group facilitator, weaving in family violence in all their programs and supporting family with loved ones affected by drug and alcohol. Before I go further, I'd like to do acknowledgement to country. So new excavations of a rock shelter near Kakadu National Park indicate that humans reached Australia at least 65,000 years ago, approximately 18,000 years prior to what archaeologists first thought. Excavation found a wealth of artifacts, including ground edge axes, grindstones, flints and ore, as well as evidence of fireplaces right through the site. It suggests that there is a very, very deep cultural continuity and connection between the people living in Kakadu today and probably those living over 65,000 years ago. The British colonisation of Australia was a long and violent process whereby Indigenous people were forcibly dispossessed of their land and territory by European soldiers, settlers, pastoralists, police, miners and seafarers. I want to pay my respects to their elders, past, present and emerging, any elders in the room, and also say that we all stand to privilege, or we all do privilege from the colonisation of the land on which we are meeting today. So thank you very much. The aim today is that Nelmini and I are going to facilitate a discussion. And it's about getting a little uncomfortable because we all know, I'm very conscious of the expertise in the room. We all know that when we get uncomfortable, that's where growth happens. We're going to try and put aside what we think we know and be open to a process of exploration where we can perhaps disrupt the dominant narrative and explore pluralities that might be possibilities in that domain. And by doing that, we have to put together a discomfort agreement. And those of you that have joined us in previous forums, we don't do a comfortable agreement, we do a discomfort agreement. Yes, we still create a safe space. We look at things like, we set up an intersectionality learning space, we support difference, we support equality and equity, we learn from each other, we share with one another. And just for time's sake, I have put together a list of clarifying with genuine view of understanding, acceptance and tolerance, supporting each other's growth, permission to get it wrong personally and as a group. And I stand here saying, please correct me. I am not standing here as an expert. I'm standing here as someone that may have a different toolbox to every single one of you in the room. And we're here to share tools, exchange them, and help each of us grow and walk out of here reflecting on some different learnings. We question with curiosity and a place of wanting to learn and grow. We accept that there are many narratives and ways of understanding. We allow time for ideas to unfold, recognizing that some people take longer to articulate themselves and form their ideas, and giving them the space and respect to do that by practicing patience. Obviously, there's no wrong or right in this work. We're all here to think of other possibilities of doing what we do. or patting ourselves on the back for doing a damn good job, which we all do always. Respecting people's choices not to speak or participate if they so wish. Being aware of personal triggers and managing them. Getting uncomfortable and willing to deconstruct our ideas, beliefs, and mindsets. Obviously, respecting confidentiality. Some of us tend to share in groups like this, especially when they're so intimate. And maybe if we can de-identify if we're going to share stories outside this room. How does that sound? Sorry about my voice, I'm getting over a cold. So, ongoing check-ins, taking care of ourselves and each other in the group. And how do we manage conflict? How do we manage disagreements? Anyone want to suggest how you propose how we can manage conflict or disagreements? Agree to disagree in a respectful manner, yeah. We can maybe write down things on a sticky note that might have come up for us during conversation or during the presentation, and maybe at the end we can discuss it. We can have a little car park on the whiteboard and we can place them on and, you know, come back to them a little way down before we finish. Yeah, we've got sticky notes there on the table for you. Happy to discuss everything. So I'll put this up and... before I say anything more, I'll get Nalmini to introduce herself.
Hi everybody. I think I've met some of you before. I'm Nalmini. I'm a educator, researcher, and a lot of, and I just would like to say that I identify myself, the pronouns are she and hers, and I identify myself as a migrant settler of colour. So my location is what's important, and we're doing a lot of work on intersectionality. That is my area of specialism, and locating myself makes me conscious right at the front of my mind that we are still living on colonized land, and we'll be hammering that in, but I'm sure that all of you already subscribe to that. Would that be right to say that we are totally conscious of that? And what we're gonna do is that to apply intersectionality in a way that it's often not applied. It's not deep enough, it's not critical enough, and it doesn't use the full potential of intersectionality. So we're very conscious that we're with advanced practitioners in the room, so we're not going to give you any 101, but if you have basic questions, do not hesitate to discuss, because a common agreement on terms is really important, because we all call things different things. And just to say that, you know, what we're trying to do is colonization, as Patrick Wolf said, is not an event, it's a structure. So we are all still living under those very, very same structures. And so it's really important what we can do now. We're not here with guns and smallpox blankets and whatever. What we can do now is to interrupt the perpetuation and the maintenance of those structures. Does that make sense? And as practitioners, we're in the field of where we do things. We trying to do good, but very often we can be harming while we try to help. So that's kind of the thrust of it. So I'm going to bring in some critical race stuff. And we talk a lot about race because it's the one that's most difficult to talk about in Australia, and it affects every other kind of difference that goes on. So and it's focused very much on culture. So we'll be talking about culture in different ways, but most of all wanting you to put in what you think. A lot of the knowledge, we haven't been educated. I took years to study this stuff, and I'm still learning every day. So to unlearn what we've been pumped full of is going to take time. So it's about unlearning, and that's why all the reflection and you know, reciprocity as well is really important. So the way that intersectionality is a thinking tool, it's a theory, it's a framework that says that we don't live single issue lives, and that having discrete different identities when a person has got, when they're oppressed under multiple identities, not just one. So if ever you have a gender oppression, it is also made different by race. So a white woman will be oppressed in a different way to me as a woman of colour. Through my gender will be used differently. So if you're a client in incarceration, in custody, you know, her Aboriginality is a huge factor in how she experiences racism and sexism. So all of those things are interlocking. And The way it's practiced is, we've done three sessions on this already, so maybe you could catch up and do it again a different next time, but it's undone. The potential of it is undone. It emerged from black feminist lived experience in the US through the context of slavery. It has also been developed women of color all over the world in post-colonial migration and so on. And it's very, very important in multicultural cities like this. So we have a lot of difference in others and other others. So intersectionality is malpracticed, I think, by focusing on discrete identities and thinking that they're separate. So even though we say they're happening all together, people are still practicing it as if they can be reduced to separate axes, right? So what is never looked at is power. So this is a version of intersectionality that I based from Patricia Hill Collins's work. You always hear Kimberly Crenshaw. Nobody reads her stuff deeply enough to realize what she's actually saying. So that's the other thing. It just gets picked up and just mentioned, and then you're back to business as usual. So there's not enough critical and deep engagement with the work of people of color, especially women of color. So what Patricia Hill Collins has done here is said that there are, in any form, any site of oppression, there are interlocking. So one can't work without the other. It's not like they're added together, one after the other. One only works when all the others are there. All right? And she finds four kinds of power that are present in every situation of oppression. So we've got the person in the middle, okay? So that's your interpersonal power. How empowered you are, how free are you to move, speak, change your mobility, move around geographically, that's freedom. So the interpersonal power and your agency. We all have agency, but not all of us can exercise it because of all the other powers that block it. Then we've got disciplinary power, which is a Foucauldian idea, which is let's start from the outside. Structural power is the big power over that Mel was talking about. Police, courts, the law, immigration, all those big things that we can't change immediately. And the big power here is the settler colonial structure. And disciplinary power is an interesting link because what we do, we are all in that domain of power. We run organizations. We say you can have our service, you can't have our service. Or you can use this card, you can't use that card. So we have eligibility. So disciplinary power enacts, according to Hill Collins, enacts just the dirty work of the state structural power. We actually effectuate, we actually make it happen. So there's a policy and then we get to implement it. Okay?
For example, a worker that I work with works for one of the crisis centres, and she said that an Australian woman was given a bag of nappies for her child, and a woman from an ethnic background was made to ask the person that was in charge for a nappy every time her baby soiled it. This is the organisation, but someone working for the organisation using that power.
It gives us a way to talk about that kind of occasion. Does that make sense? We need words and ideas and frameworks to talk about those things.
That's another aspect of.
And then you see what gets framed out, you know? So the intersectional theories are for marginalised. You know, we're looking at how they become marginalised rather than just saying they're different, they're difficult to deal with, they're difficult to reach. That whole idea of making the difficulty about them, okay? Rather than that, we're looking at we'll put that person in the middle or that group and we look out to all the powers that are obstructing their agency, okay? So.
Can we say violence, like forms of violence? Is power a form of violence?
Definitely, but there are different forms of, power is a form of violence. So basically we think of violence, we think of military violence, gun violence, but there's also discursive violence. By stereotyping somebody, discursive means you're saying it. Okay, so you're actually being violent by saying they can't exist or you are a refugee rather than saying I'm from Afghanistan. So the labelling, the categorising in the very first place is one of the biggest colonial tools that was used. And the framing and the naming of that. So discursive violence, which is never talked about in Australia, it's kind of surprising. There's state violence, policy violence, which in America, like if you look at Ferguson and Mississippi, they call it fiscal violence. It's a policy violence that affects a particular group of people and makes them pay the price with their lives. And there's a physical violence. They're all connected. So we just think, violence is an individually perpetrated, but it comes from somewhere. And it's the thought, the ideas, the naming. Yeah, so there are lots of different, and there's cultural violence, and there's, But okay, that's a good, can you jot that down as an idea to discuss?
The idea would be, what really constitutes family violence?
Yeah, I know. So what we'll do, we're just jumping ahead. This is a thinking tool. No, it's good, it's great. Thinking tool. So what I've done with it is I've mapped it onto every other project I've done. So I've done one for financial abuse and family violence. I've done one for the death of Miss Du in custody. I've done one for asylum seeking. So what I'm trying to say is in this model, trying to say that you can use this model and map it where you need to map it, and from there try to gauge what's going on. When you know what's going on, you'll be able to pick the things that matter most in that moment and matter first and work on those. So it's a strategic tool and it's an analytic tool, it's a thinking tool. Yeah, but we often forget to think about power.
And I think also sometimes, well, not sometimes, quite deliberately, they get us looking at the individual rather than as a deficit model and what's going on for them and why aren't they getting where they want to get, the problems with them, rather than focusing on every other layer. Yes, Daniel.
So there are two stages and I wasn't really planning on going into it. But yeah, but what I'm also saying is a lot of people skip that step. And to be able to, you need to identify and name and have a literacy, right, in order to talk about something. So that is, for me, what intersectionality is. It's a form of race, gender, class, literacy, so we can recognise what's going on and we can read situations with what's going on and we can remember all the elements we have to remember. Does that make sense? Yeah. So disciplinary and culture, then, is the mediating force. So you've got the state here, the big bad state who wants everybody to pay their taxes and they want rich people to prosper and poor people to be homeless and all that stuff. Then there's like the disciplinary power is how they get us, I suppose, in their state departments. We do good, but we also don't. An identity is a way of excluding someone, right? So an identity is a very important thing. You need to have the right identity to get the service, right, to access your rights. So what they do is an earlier step. You can't have that identity. You can't be a refugee, but you can be an asylum seeker. So there's lots more identities being formed to prevent access to the rights that everybody should enjoy. Okay? So cultural power mediates the two. So it's the how it's done. So that today is mostly about culture and what we mean by power, you know, cultural power. It's a very important thing because we not only make culture, we also replicate it and reproduce it. So that's intersectionality. Was that helpful?
And we'll unpack it a lot more as we're getting deeper into it.
So let's have some practical. Yeah. Okay. So power is spatial. That's the message there. Power is spatially organised. And it matters where you are geographically and physically. And also look at the difference in the room.
For all the reasons that we just mentioned and we just spoke about. Safety, socioeconomic. If I'm going for a date, I would rather sail from Vermont South than I would say from Meadows. Same for if I'm going for an interview. Yeah? Centrelink, it might work for me if I say from Broadmeadows though. Yeah? If I go in there as a victim and, you know, I'm a really needy person, if I say from Vermont South, they're not going to look at my form. Go back home. Yeah? Seriously, what do you think about this comment that I just made? Can it work either way? I mean,
basically just wanting to talk a little bit differently about, so Manal's going to just talk to you about what is faith.
Look, faith and culture, I mean, some people mistake faith for religion. Is there a difference between religion and faith?
Yes.
What's the difference?
Other than talking about sort of the values and beliefs of faith, what we need to get out here is how is faith used and collapsed into understanding this culture, and what does that do to the bodies that are observing? So can we talk about that for a second? Could I also ask people to think about what faiths are important and which are the most important thing way faith is used at the moment in terms of classifying, hierarchicizing, and, you know...
Survive.
Sorry?
Survive.
How is faith used to make people, which ones matter at the moment? Which
one?
Christianity.
Christianity is the one that supposedly teaches us the right from.
Okay, so there is a dominance going on. That's what we're trying to get to.
And there's a fear where the terrorists are the Muslim faith at the moment.
Yeah.
Yeah? So it's used for just like institutes of government, parliament houses and houses of God. They're both using power to dominate others. Yeah.
But what's really interesting.
Yeah, so that image that Manal found, it's talking about Islamophobia, which is the new enemy has been made into the Muslim person since 9/11, basically. But when you look at we talk about intersectionality, the gender and the race. If you look at the veil, is the symbol. So what Manal has put on earlier, all those symbols are quick messages. They kind of label people too. But there's some symbols that are lifted out and made to look really different, but actually, are they that different? So what is it that makes them different?
So if I didn't have those names of all these people, some people might take a quick glance at that any woman that walks in their service with a scarf on, automatically she's a Muslim.
Yeah.
Even Sikh women or whatever. Unfortunately, some Sikh men get confused for being Muslim men.
They get beaten up.
Yeah, exactly, unfortunately. So I just wanted to highlight that not because a woman wears a scarf and comes to your service, that assumption, that bias, that she's Muslim, she's a terrorist, she could be hiding something under her veil or whatever it is.
That's unconscious.
So what we're talking about here is the politics and the power in how bodies are read and what that means. So it's very different for a person wearing a hat or a hoodie versus somebody wearing a headscarf. There is a material qualitative difference in the way they walk through the world and how they're treated. So this is both sides of the coin, right? Sometimes we try and say there's no difference. Sometimes we try and say there is a huge difference. So that's the range, the tension between identifying different bodies and reading race into the bodies, which is the point that we're sort of getting to. But race is hidden under faith. It's hidden under culture. It's hidden under,
somehow the focus then will be on.
Okay. Right. So what we are trying to figure out today and open up is what that somehow is. Okay? Right? How does that get to be the situation?
Media.
Right? Media is a huge thing, but what are we as workers who are in that disciplinary, are we doing things that are actually subscribing to that, or are we disrupting them?
No,
we're
blaming the media and the politics rather than taking some responsibility.
Well, I don't know if we should point, but we are also part of it. We can never be outside that system. Whatever we think, whatever we say, we are always in it. So admitting that, for example, when you admitted your privilege, that's the way to do it, right? That's the way to move forward, to say, I'm part of this. So the question is, why is it so difficult for a lot of people to do that work, right? So that's what we're trying to... So we're just going to move on because I'm just conscious about the time. What are people's perceptions? I think we could skip... Shall we skip this one or...? Okay, so, we're up to slide 10 out of 50, so...
very quick.
Okay, who do you think is the majority in this country? What culture is the majority? What religion is the majority? Just call it out.
Religion.
Christians. Christians is the big majority, okay. And what kind of Christians are the majority? Okay, you got it right so far. What's the minority? What's the smallest? Religion. Which religion is the smallest proportion? Yeah, we're pretty close. Buddhism's there. Okay. Yeah, it's not even on the rate. It's not even on there. So it's Sikh is the last one. Yeah, it's 0.5. Okay, that's not a religion. Okay, so what's the fastest growing religion, do you think?
Buddhism.
Anyone else? Okay, it says Hinduism here. It jumped 60%.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
This was from the census,
2016 census, yeah, of Australia, yeah. And Buddhism has gone 2.4, Islam 2.6. Biggest ethnic group?
Chinese.
Indian?
Put down that, but yeah, this is really interesting. Who said Chinese was said first,
yeah.
Indian was said second. What others?
Anglo.
Who said Anglo? All right. And New Zealanders, okay. Anyone else? Okay, so 25%, I'll give you the answer, 25% English, an Australian 25%. This is identity of an Irish, Scottish. So no Chinese. Chinese is third from the end, but we have a perception, right? Why is that? Okay. And also, what else did we say? So basically, our Naomi hit it on the head. But we were mostly wrong. 25%, that's a quarter, right? All right, so I'm going to go back. What about language?
Oh, I just said language.
You saw the answer. Okay, so that last line to me was fascinating. Do we ever, ever talk about that?
No.
8,100 Australians practice Aboriginal traditional religion. Mm. Okay? Yeah, okay. So what we're going to do now is we're just going to watch something, and we're going to ask you to answer some questions after the video. So this is, I'll just get it up to the, Manal, do you want to pass around the response sheets?
So what is culture? In Australia, from when I was a boy, our culture was invisible, or we were a problem and a burden. And then I started to read about heroes and warriors. My mum, when I was about 12, 11, gave me the book Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee and Papillon. And from Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee, I learned about resistance. And from Papillon, I learned never give up. When life slaps you down, get up and slap the bastard back. You know, I slapped the thing so hard, I'm wondering why they haven't taken it off me. And then I learned about cultural interpretation. And I learned about cultural loads about 15 years ago. I knew about them before then, but I want to show you, when you talk to an Aboriginal theatre practitioner, whether they're a behind-the-scenes person, whether they're a producer, whether they're an actor, whether they're a writer, they write from this perspective, and I need a volunteer. How are you going there, brother? You nervous?
Yeah.
Do you fly up then? I'll just get you to just stand there, and what we'll do, I need another volunteer. Who can, no, just stand there, look to the front, don't be scared, the arms down, relax. Okay. All right. You ready? Okay. Anyone here watch Harry Potter? Yeah, just hands up. Yeah. Young lady, would you mind standing up? Yeah. Would you mind being Hermione from Harry Potter for a moment? I just want you to change Davo here into a 19-year-old non-Aboriginal girl. Any type of spell will do. Thank you very much. Well done. Please grab a seat. Okay, now we need a name for her. Anyone got a name for Davo?
Beryl.
Oh, thank you very much. All right, Beryl. All right, so let's imagine I need a volunteer to come up and write things down on the board. Good on you, Chris Mead. Thank you, brother. Come up here. Thank you, Chris. Oh, look at you, handsome thing, yeah. I'm going to start up that Koori Hair Fusion Clinic. And make it reconciliation. So we'll just write cultural loads. We'll use a black pen. Oh, you can flip it if you want. Oh, you just do it here. Yeah, here you go. Cultural loads. So let's say you pay tax, you've got a job at the real estate agent. Yep. Don't put these inside each other. I'll think it's Freudian and I'm not into that type of reconciliation. Okay. You pay tax, little job at a real estate agent. Yep. Got a little flat, you pay rent.
Yep.
Yeah, two bedroom.
Oh, two and a half.
Okay. And you got a boyfriend or you play the field?
A
bit loose.
Yeah, a bit loose.
Okay,
yeah.
All right. So you go to the doctor a lot for STDs. So social, you hang out a lot?
Yeah.
A bit of fun here and there? All right. Then you got a little car for that drive of shame on a Sunday morning. go to the gym?
Of course.
Yeah. And family relationships. Oops, there we go. So that's about, everyone agree that that's what we all sort of carry, black water brindle? Yeah? Just a general grunt will do. I know it's early in the morning for you. Yeah? Okay. So now we're going to do, Hermione, you there? Okay, could you change Beryl into a 19-year-old Aboriginal girl? There you go. Well done, you're very good at this, aren't you? So now you're an Aboriginal girl. Let's see what you carry. So you're Eastern tribe. Yeah. So they've taken away your language. So do you want to know your language?
I think so. Yeah.
Okay, you've got your language. Yeah. Your father's dead. because 52, 57 is the life expectancy, so you carry that. You look after a lot of siblings?
Yep.
Okay. All right, geez, how are you going there?
Doing really good.
Yeah. Now, in Victoria, the 97% of Aboriginal people face discrimination at least 8 times a year, and 70% worry about whole family copying it. So, a lot of discrimination. You get followed in shops.
Yep.
Oops. Oh, there you go. You're losing it. You need a cousin. You need a cousin. Excuse me, what's your name? Oh, you can't. Yeah. What's your name up there, brother? You in the green shirt? Come up here, Josh. So, Josh, you've been in jail. You've been riding because most black fellas... how many Aboriginal people here? Just hold your hand up. Okay, who here's got family in jail? Just hold your hand up. All of us. That's the way it is. So, Josh, welcome Josh, if you would. So you've been in jail. Just stand there, Josh. Don't touch them yet. So you've been in jail. So you got out. So you've got agoraphobia because you were taken away at the age of 5. You've been in institutions your whole life. You never go outside. All right? So you're living in that flat there. And you're here with Cuzzo. You're also suffering from a thing called lateral violence, where there's a conflict between your family and the local organisation. Sometimes it erupts in violence. Yeah? So in going out, what's the percentage, what's the chance, any Aboriginal person in the room, what's the chance of Beryl getting into a physical altercation? Okay. Everyone agree with that? Chance of violence. Okay, how much money are you handling out of your wage weekly to family? Anyone? Any Aboriginal person? Okay, there we go. When you go to the local shop and get followed, how many times out of 10 going to the local supermarket do you get followed? Any Aboriginal person? Okay. Oh, you know what I do when they follow me? I turn around and follow them back. I say, where are we going? I go, you're going to turn me, brother. Just get back, sir. You're making me uncomfortable. So Josh is a bit of an aggro person because in jail he can't read or write properly, even though that's why he was taken away. So Josh is getting his mates to read the letters out to him. Beryl's been writing and saying, I've been fighting with this mob again and again. So in jail he's been geeing himself up. So when he gets out, he's going to go into protective mode. Next thing you know, you've got 15 funerals a year, which is the average. That's from a report I did called Forever Business, which is online. You can get hold of it. Interviewed 131 Aboriginal people. So this is your practitioner coming into practice, okay? Their artwork. 15 funerals a year, bang. Sister's dead. 4 kids. Should she take the kids, everybody? Hands up for yes. Okay, 4 kids. Statistically, these kids are going to have either otitis media, trichinoma, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, ADHD, or another social order dysfunction. Pick 2. Anyone? Diabetes?
ADHD.
Yep, another one? Okay. You're not doing too good here, are you?
Yeah.
How are you feeling there?
I need bigger arms.
Bigger arms. Josh, at this point, flips out. Hold on a minute. How many people, Rachel Maz, are going to stay at this house for the funeral? At least 20, did you say? 20? 20 people? Is there going to be alcohol there? Okay. Are there going to be police? Is there going to be a raid? Josh is going to lose it. Josh, you better hand over these because you're going back to jail. Okay, all right. We'll just pop them at the feet. Okay, we'll just pop them at these feet. There. Thanks, Josh. Round of applause for Josh. Okay. So, here we go. This is your average Aboriginal practitioner. Now, not everyone carries this massive cultural load because sometimes family protect them. Sometimes they get to dodge it and duck and weave around it. Last year, 8 funerals for me. I only went to about 5 or 4, I can't remember. Speaking to my nephew today, they just turned off his extended family uncle's life support system yesterday. and he's in a high-pressure situation at the moment. So these types of things is when you're going to collaborate, when you're an Aboriginal artist, be it actor, be it arts administrator, be it stagehand, writer, director, producer, this is what they walk in with.
What feelings and values came up for you? So, you're saying for you, for your insight, is power privilege. Privilege comes from, well, it makes you think that you can know, that you can even know what that person has been through when there is absolutely no way you could know that. Basically, you cannot know that. So we can't say, oh, I understand. It's a very difficult for the, I think, for the client to hear that.
Absolutely.
And not
stereotype, not to put people in boxes. Mm. Mm.
But also just not to, we think we can, what right do we got to know somebody? Everything about somebody. Have we got the right to surveil their bodies? To know everything about them? So that is also a power, to presume that we have that right. But as workers, we have that privilege. Any other comments? I think that was really great. All three. So that's a really important thing. So that the standpoint, somebody was talking about standpoint, what does that mean about how the service has been set up? How the policies have been written, how every single service is set up to look at the individual as disconnected from their
families, their communities.
Yeah.
And we develop policies like legislation.
I just wanted to say that something like this can help us become more creative in our own individual practice. For example, yesterday a client that I have said to me that her son's psychologist texted her and said, your son's thinking of going to rehab. He didn't have to do that. The feeling she got just from that one text message. And this is something that was over and beyond his work, his practice. He wasn't going to get into trouble for it, you know, but it gave her such hope and calm that it really uplifted her spirit. So people can do things that, you know, be creative and think of how can I connect with the person? How can I give them hope? What can I do at my level? And maybe as a team, we don't have to look right up there to the structural stuff and think we're going to change things up there. But you can make a difference in someone's life with your own little practice.
It's each of those cups. So like forever after I watch that, if anybody comes into my space, I just think, how many cups are they carrying? You know, and what's inside them? You know, it just gives you a metaphor. Metaphors are great ways of remembering everything. You know, like you were saying, how do you keep everything going at once? Any other comments about that feedback? We're going to show you some videos next. And for each one, I want you to look at framing.
Does anyone know what framing? I mean, I'm sure everyone here has some level of understanding of what framing means, how we frame our story. Sometimes we can frame a story from a victim perspective, a hero perspective, and sometimes it could be from a learning and exploring a possibilities.
Perception?
Yeah, perception, yeah. So sometimes the media might frame a certain story in a particular way, but when we hear it ourselves or we experience something ourselves, we find it to be completely different. For example, I was brought up in Australia and I was told that Jews and Muslims don't mix. Unconsciously, in all the cartoons and everything I watched, villains are always Arab, so I didn't identify as an Arab. And then I had the opportunity when my parents whisked me off to Egypt at the age of 17 or so. Lived in a flat, everyone's in flats, middle class family, never met my family before that. And I found that in the same building were Jews, Coptics, Muslims, Italians and Greeks, a vast range, diversity of different peoples, and everyone was in each other's flat. Everyone knew each other's business, breakfast, lunch and dinner. It was overwhelming for me because here we're all separated. Like we don't even know our neighbors. We just hello, hello, goodbye, goodbye from the fence or whatever. But everyone knew each other. If someone's sick, everyone was there. And it was like, hang on a minute, but that's not what I'm told. And also during the spring rising, I was in front of the TV set here 24/7, Al Jazeera News, all the news channels, and I thought Egypt was under siege, the whole of Cairo, everything. I happened to go there for a few days to visit my daughter who got married. And to Harira Square, there were four concrete boulders, two tanks. Everyone else was going about their business. So it's not the picture that we were getting here. So that sort of opened up my eyes to who's doing the framing? What are they putting in the picture? Which could be just as important as what they're leaving out. What are they leaving out? Just gets me to think and wonder.
So for each of these, if you can just have a little think, look at the lens through which the video is framed. These are all stories about our others, okay? And who's the, what's the story there? What's the storyline? Who's who in the story? And what's the message? So each of these is how, it's the how we are conditioned to think in a certain way, how differences are manufactured, we could say, and they're made to matter when actually, you know, so there is always a political reason why differences are made to matter, okay? So so the first one, is that all clear for everyone? What we're just gonna show it to you? And just react, just open your heart, open your mind and just listen.
My mother said we had to leave home. The communists were going to take my father away. If my parents were afraid, they didn't show us. But we would never forget our escape from Vietnam. We were lost.
What was your job in Vietnam?
University professor.
We had no home.
Do you have any family in Canada?
No, sir.
Nobody wanted us.
Welcome to Canada.
Canada chose us.
Canadians opened their borders, their homes, and their hearts to more than 100,000 refugees fleeing persecution after the Vietnam War.
We were home.
Okay, so could you just... Oh, yeah. How did you feel? What did you feel after watching that? How else did other people feel when you were watching that? What did it evoke inside you?
Canadians selling their country.
Okay, so it was a marketing, right? They were using it to market something. What were they using to market? What were they marketing? What were they?
Donation.
So we know something's not right. Yeah. Did everybody like? Did you all feel there was something? Yeah.
Yeah. Very scripted.
Very scripted, right? So it was manufactured, right? It was pointing us to exactly get the message they wanted us to get from that.
Well, to evoke an emotional response.
And what was the emotional response?
Sympathy, empathy.
Yeah, yeah, good. Mm-hmm.
The white saviour.
Yeah, and yeah, exactly. How were the brown bodies used to market and what were they marketing?
The undergarments.
Yes, okay. And just tell me how that happened. I mean, the little girl with the little big sad eyes and... You know, that whole, how were the people of colour portrayed in that? As... Right, so there was that benevolence, white benevolence.
Yeah.
So always looking for the other side. What's the other side of white benevolence? Is gratitude, the expectation of gratitude. So as Manal was saying earlier, you have to look poor enough to go and get to the Centrelink office. You have to fit into a certain way that you have been portrayed to be in order to access that service. So you can be too, like a woman, homeless person who I was working with, she took a shower and she looked too clean. So the homeless man got in her bed and she didn't get an accommodation for the night. It has material effects. No, so that's one of the biggest mistakes we all make is thinking because I got through it, right, you should get through it too. We can never ever afford to do that. You know, I think that's, it's a really tricky thing to deal with. So, you know, and so people of different class, you know, we looked at intersectionality, looking at the different class location and power. So we, power wants to frame people that way because that's what makes everything flow. That's how the system keeps going. Yeah? So we're just going to watch. Anything else you want to say about that? Okay. All right. So we're going to see another one now. Same exercise.
Munjed is the world's leader in osteointegration surgery. Fern is a dentist and yoga teacher with her own practice in Port Melbourne. Najiba has a Bachelor of Medical Science and is now studying a second degree in international law. They and many others are capable, resourceful, talented Australians who can all say the same thing.
I came by boat.
I came by boat.
I came by boat.
People who seek asylum are forced onto the sea because it's safer than the land upon which they come from. When they come to this country, they bring resilience, courage, entrepreneurship, a thirst for freedom. They make this country even greater, and we should welcome them.
So we decided to celebrate people who came by boat. We are producing a poster campaign in which we are trying to convey that these are people with courage and humanity, and if allowed into Australia, can contribute greatly to society. We got together an amazing crew who donated their time to create the posters. Advertising isn't cheap. We need your help so that the posters can be placed in bus shelters and train stations all over the country. We would like these posters to be seen by as many people as possible. The more money we can raise, the more impact we can have. We'd also like to hear from more asylum seekers who came by boat, so that their stories can be told in posters and on the web. Please contact us if you would like to participate. We need to reinforce the tolerance and compassion that Australians are capable of. We need to welcome people seeking our protection, regardless of how they get here. Please support our project. And if you cannot help financially, please share this link on social media. Thank you.
So, same thing again, just a little reflection on what it brought up for you. How have they been constructed to be perceived? How? Well, how are we made taught to think about them? As? A burden? What else? Criminals, terrorists. What else? Queue jumpers. So we've already got.
We need to fear them.
Yep, so we've got six things already. What else? Dirty, infested, not citizenship, you know, they can't follow the rules. All kinds of ways that they've been illegal, and so they've been constructed. So this message is trying to talk back against that discourse. Is it going to fix the problem? And it's trying to say that our good white selves, who are really compassionate, can fix years and years and years of colonization. It can fix years and years and years of vilifying those bodies and refugee bodies and the structural laws that support it. Okay, so that's what I would call a critical reading. Any other things to add to that? So really well done.
Yeah.
So who has the control of the media? Has the power, right, of representing what they want, and all the other side stories silence up all the alternate narratives of truths that people are telling us. The whole session is called Plurality. It's about there are multiple truths, right? But we only ever get to hear one that's all about power. And I think that the relationship, there's a book out at the moment, it's very good. The relationship is the solution, right?
Absolutely.
The relationship is the aim of all this stuff. It's actually the relational, what happens is it becomes transactional, right? I'm here to give you something, you're here to take it. You know, I'm the good one, I'm the benefactor, you know, I'm the giver, you're the supplicant, you know? Power, 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 power dynamics all the time.
Mutuality.
Yeah, mutuality and reciprocity. How far do we go to understand the other? Okay? And I think that the other point that you made, and I think somebody else made it as well, is the elevation. It's always saying, has it worked for Indigenous people to show the successful ones? Has it worked to show for South Sudanese, to show Deng, which we were going to show you, but we won't have time, to show the one black surgeon? Does it work? Has it ended racism in America to have Obama had been there? It doesn't work, no. Right?
Because white people are always a saviour, and the deficit identities are always people of colour or the othered.
So what is it really doing? So when we have a policy, when we have a programme, when we have a message, we need to ask, it's not just what it says, it's what it's doing that really matters, right? So those videos, we could be sharing them. We could be saying, oh, this is so good. She asked us in that video to promote, if you can't give money, this is the next best thing. So she's asking us to promote that. This is why how we inadvertently do harm, why we think we're trying to educate people, because we are not critical thinking. Is that, yes?
I'll just come
So this is a point about culture. Is it created? That's what you're exactly saying. You're saying, do we create culture or do we have culture and then we put it on the media? It works both ways. There's culture being created every minute. So it's not always, and doesn't get always transmitted through identity, right? Third culture people, our kids, who have nothing to do with us. You know, my son was named Samudra, he's now Sam, you know? So they make their own way in the world. So I can't say to him, you're Sri Lankan, right? Because he doesn't identify with it. So it doesn't always go with identity. So I think there's a lot of questions here, more questions than answers. But I think the critical thinking and the fact that we try to, it's also subscribing to the contract, the social contract, that you've got to be useful, you've got to be earning money, you've got to be paying taxes. So there is a price attached to being Australian, right? For being a refugee, you can only be this kind of refugee, but if you're that kind of refugee, we don't want you. So there you have Manus, and then you have Deng Adut in Western Sydney. And they used Deng, the Sudanese lawyer, they used him to market diversity. Yeah, yeah. That's the title. The relationship is the program on the title. Yeah, there's a load of really good creative practitioners in there. So tea time. Do you want to see Deng? Just quickly. Am I hammering this point home? Too far? Okay. It's hard to know. Yeah. Okay. So critical thinking. That's all I'm saying. Deng. Okay, so watch this and just think about what is being sold. We're in a capitalist society. What are they selling here? What work is that body doing? What work is the ad doing? It's an ad, even though it looks like a humanitarian message, right? Think about all those things.
That's really emotional. My God.
That's how it is intended to be.
Yeah, I know. I know it is. I've seen it like 10 times and I still get emotional. Just everything, the music, his story, you can sort of fill in the gaps.
You know the horrible thing about this to me?
So what we're talking about here is the representation. They're taking your story. Absolutely. They're disembodying it. At least Deng was embodied. And then they're marketing it, and then the message, the takeaway, what you need to do is just their agenda, not yours. Absolutely. Right? So by doing representing people in this way, representing the other, they're creating like encounters. So every time we see a film like this, or I feel all the time when I see family violence policy, I think, you know, it's telling me how to think about it. It doesn't match what really happens. And that makes me so frustrated. So basically it's exploitative. And the reason, your key words being 10 years, nothing changed. So what I started off this session saying that what we're trying to do is to look at how we're maintaining and perpetuating those structures, right? You know,
if I can say this, as soon as I came in, I saw this camera and... I mean, I don't know what it was. I mean, you saw me at the last session we had here. Yeah. I wasn't as nervous and as apprehensive as I am today, even avoiding I speak because sometimes I forget that the camera is there.
Yeah.
Because to me it was like, is this going to be a repetition of all of these things?
Yeah.
I was extremely, extremely concerned that I was feeling very, very.
I think that's a, Manal, you can, don't forget to talk about that point of when people walk into your space. When you walk into the space, how are you remembering that these are the people, what they've been through? They're walking in. How safe and unsafe are they made to feel by the artifacts in the room, by the way it's set up, that kind of physical safety? But just to go back to the video, any other comments about the video? What did it frame out? What did it portray them and us? Well, who were the thems and who were the heroes, who were the villains in that? Who were the heroes?
The university.
Yep. Who else? Yep. Who else? There were other heroes.
Yuen,
thank you. Who else?
Deng.
And Deng. Okay, right. Okay, and who were the villains in that?
Sudanese.
Yeah, yeah. The army, the military, the black people, basically. Mm-hmm. The uncivilized, savage black people. And what's left out of there? What's left out of there? Of that whole story?
Who they're attacking. We didn't see who they're attacking.
No, and also how those conflicts take place. You know, military intervention, Saddam Hussein, Gaddafi. Gaddafi was about to set up an Arab bank just before he died. You know, so it's always about something. It's got to be more, less naive. Somebody said the word naive. You know, I think I find my, one of the biggest gaps for me between my life and people of, and white people is their political naivety. I just think, how can you even trust the police? How could you even think that the police are good? I find that really hard to take. I really do. Because it happens a lot in feminism, white feminism, saying, call the police, here's how we're going to help you. And I'm thinking, if I call the police, you know, if an Aboriginal woman calls the police, she'll get arrested, she'll lose her kids, she'll be put in jail. How can you trust the police so much? Because they serve white people differently to people of colour. So I think political naivety and racial illiteracy is one of the biggest problems. I'm going to say I read a lot of stuff, and you know, but I'm just saying that it's a really big issue, and I'm a bit passionate about it, in case you hadn't noticed. But if you want things to change, and if you don't want things to keep going and replicating and reproducing, this is the work that needs to be done. Any other comments about the video? All the white people are the saviors, so the white savior discourse, and the uncivilized, savage, brown people are the ones who need us. And it's not about white people. Whiteness is a system. Yeah. And we're going to talk about that next. It's not a person. And it's not a colour. Yeah.
The white fragility.
Yeah. So that a construct of Deng could not have got there without the white person. To me, that's the message. The subconscious message that's coming out.
The origins of that war.
Yes, exactly.
And again, the exception to the rule. All those videos showed exceptions.
Yeah.
It's not the everyday. Mm-hmm. I can't see myself in that.
No.
A woman coming out of family violence with three kids and now being homeless on the street can't identify.
She would never think I'm going to study at Western University.
like seriously?
She might be thinking of
some. She would not. I don't think so. I don't think so, because he's totally assimilated.
Survival.
So you can be a good migrant and a good refugee if you totally assimilate. If you dress like us, talk like us, do the jobs we do, make money like we do, some of us choose to work on the grassroots and not go into the government, you know?
Literally pass that test.
Yeah, so you've got to pass that test. And shall we have a quick tea break? We've just got 45 minutes left, so just wanted to, some of the things that came up were, I just wanted to bring, like I talk about tensions and whatever, What does multiculturalism do that blocks us being able to see racism and speak about racism, right? So that's a key thing in Australia. It's been well identified in critical race theory and stuff, that multiculturalism can obstruct our view of what really goes on. So it can be something that gets in the way. And also how diversity gets mixed up with intersectionality. They become collapsed, and then those words become meaningless. You know, the thing becomes meaningless. So just that multiculturalism, you know, is always often expressed in food, habits, greetings, clothes, music. But actually, we have seen from all the other things, it has really strong political impacts, right? And one of the things is it makes it hard to name institutional racism, because difference is framed as, so it's called cultural racism. Racism is now practiced through culture. So in the 90s and 80s, in the 80s and 90s, people realized that biological race is not true, right? That it was a constructed thing. So they debunked that idea, but then they changed to culture. And now the culture masks, the still racism goes on, but the culture is used as a sort of a blanket and makes it softer and difficult to talk about. So what we do, it also does is it, the, you know, there's an overt history of a shameful racist past. It covers all that up too. So it allows people to deny this racism. So anytime there's like, everybody does it, Malcolm Turnbull, all our politicians will deny, oh, that was racist. So it's a very difficult place in Australia to talk about race, but we experience racism. And multiculturalism is one of the things that stops us being able to talk about race. Now, I know that you may not agree, you know, that it's always promoted as a great thing, but when we have seen before, there are good ways to be different and bad ways to be different, right? Good ways to be multicultural and bad ways to be multicultural. Multiculturalism is all fine when it comes to food and clothes, but it's not okay for you to be the Prime Minister or for you to be, for example, Yasmin Abdel-Majid, who was, you know, made a criticism about Anzac Day, and she was virtually hounded out of the country. So basically, that's what I'm, yeah. So, and diversity, again, there's good and bad forms of diversity. And we celebrate diversity, but not all of us can qualify and occupy that identity or inhabit the identity of a good, diverse subject. So these are a bit, sort of a bit of theoretical stuff, which I think, you know, frames out race. So I have this good definition of diversity, which I think is really fantastic. This is Deborah Williams and Carolyn Bodwich. Carolyn Bodwich is a woman who lives with a disability. She's an actor, producer. She's the head of Creative Arts Victoria, Diversity Arts Victoria. And Deborah Williams is from the UK. She has done advocacy. She's also, she was born with, I think she had thalidomide, you know, so she's actually advised the British film industry and basically Hollywood about how to bring diversity into film. Two very powerful women. And I was happened to be with them last, in a two-day conference. So diversity is not a casual tolerance of anything that's not about yourself. It's not polite accommodation. It's inaction, the painful awareness that other people, other races, other voices, other habits of mind have as much integrity of being, as much claim on the world as you do. So that's, yeah? And that's William Merritt Chase, who was 1849. So it's been undone in a way. That idea of diversity that's been around for a long time has been dressed in new clothes that are more exclusionary and politically, you know, motivated. So the other thing is diversity and intersectionality can kind of, you know, cut each other out. So intersectionality urges us to think about and through the points at which power relations meet. It's not about where, and the, that happens to a body. The body is a meeting point where a load of power relations converge. And how we experience one category of identity depends on how we inhabit others. I can be a woman, but because I inhabit the category of race, I can be a different way, but also because I'm in an Australian national, I'm actually privileged in that way. So it's complex. And diversity is being framed as the happy point of interest, where all everything's great, you know? And so it can be used to deflect from racism. Okay, they'll say, we're a diverse university, or we're a diverse company. If you look at the Western Sydney, that was very much the message, happy, productive, to contributing to capital, your useful body, you're working, earning money. But then that means if we see Deng up there every time we think about, you know, we can't talk about the racism that we see every day because they made an exceptional. So, and power is being redone at the point where we imagine it as being undone. So, so does that all make sense so far? It's a bit lecture-y, sorry about that. So the root cause that we are saying for all of these, we're not looking at the root cause. The root cause is dominant whiteness and dominant power. So we've got to think about privilege as what you don't have to do and what you do have to do. And instead of, I think we're quite clear, that instead of surveilling and interrogating and exposing, asking them, where are you from, getting loads of data about the person that's supposed to be suffering, right? We need to name the systems, that persecute them. Okay? What we instead we do is, oh, something's wrong. But the solutions that we use are about them rather than looking back at what we are creating to create those conditions. So what happens if we focus on the person, we end up to victim blaming. You know, it's that person, she's this, they're lazy, and deficit identity. So there's a motivation to do things differently, because we know that the deficit identities and victim blaming are hugely problematic in our services. Do you think that they are? Do you feel like they are?
About a 2-hour assessment if you're lucky, and that's all with the person, and that should be done apparently. I'm just fortunate not to work in an organization where we do this when we first meet a client. Like, we can do that in a week, in 2 weeks time we build rapport. Shark and Y obviously are all about connection and building rapport and a relationship to get honest answers. But when you ask those type of pervasive questions at the start, are you going to get truly honest answers? Would you answer these questions yourself?
So what we're asking, remember that little twisty thing I did before, rather than what it is your process is trying to achieve, what is it doing to that relationship, right? What is that, like if you think about a technology, questions and forms are a technology of power, really, right? And what you're thinking you're getting is all the ways to help them, but what are you doing when you're getting that stuff? What are you doing to that person? Are you getting the right information? Are you getting anything useful? Or what are you actually doing again? You're just enacting the power over them. I mean, this is like broad speaking, but... So how does that sit with everybody? And this is, we were talking, I said I'll come back to it, whiteness. It's not about a colour. It's about a system. And there are lots of definitions of whiteness. So whiteness is a system. It's a dominant cultural space, it's got political significance, and it's got a purpose of keeping others on the margin, right? So central, it's about who's in the center. How is everything arranged and who's in the margins? So for example, when we say white privilege, it's all about the things white people don't have to do, okay? When you say white people, there can be brown bodies who are behaving like white people too, right? So, and who subscribe to the system, if you're, you know, so I think there's another lovely saying, Charles Mills, when he says white people may not subscribe to the system of whiteness, but they benefit from it all the same. That's a really good way to think about it, even though you don't. And I benefit from whiteness in contrast to Aboriginal people. That's why I always say I'm a settler, but I'm a migrant settler of colour, so my privileges are going to be different to a white settler. Do you see what I mean? The logic of naming, so that you're always saying, in relation to who? I can't just say I'm oppressed. I'm not, in comparison. So there are common, when we say whiteness as a system, we're not talking about the individual body, but all that it's embedded in its meanings and practices. Okay, so there's kind of this thing called the poetics, which is the representation, which is like those videos. And then there's the politics, which is the practices. So we need to look at both things. And very often we're looking all in one place and we're ignoring that place. Right, so where we're trying to undo the bad stuff, we're doing the bad stuff again with another system. So that's why intersectionality is really important, to look at all the systems that are going on at the same time.
And also what's going on inside of us is really critical ourselves. Where are our blind spots because of our own biases and our own pre-assumptions? Yeah?
So this is the reality. A few months ago, Robin DiAngelo, White Fragility. Did you realise all 97% of CEOs are white, senior leaders 95% white, 100% white prime ministers, senators 97, parliament 99, high court judges 100, and court of appeals 100. These are all the major human rights institutions and democratic institutions that we have in this country, right? So is the problem, why shouldn't we be naming whiteness as the main oppressive factor? So I think, you know, we just don't see that, right? And we always go to the American situation because they have talked about this for many more centuries than we have in Australia. So we can look at an American system. Does that surprise you, anyone? But do you often see that put up anywhere for you to reflect on? When was it, have you ever seen that being?
I even refrain myself from talking about that stuff.
Okay. Yeah.
People,
yeah. That's it. Yeah. Right. So that's how you silence it. Yeah. Thank you for saying that, for making that explicit, because it's really true. So this is the outcome.
No.
We get diversity panels. And I love this picture. So this happens every week. There is something that is like this. We're having a panel on Indigenous health. No Indigenous people on the panel. We're having a panel on women in arts. No women of colour in the arts, right? But this, for me, that image. What does it make you feel when you look at those puppies?
Cute puppies.
Yeah. So it also gives you a feeling of whiteness isn't that bad, and it's a bit innocent, you know. We don't. It's all those things operate to cover up the real harm, you know. So it's a more tolerable image to look at. So there's lots of theory on white innocence and white fragility and white, you know. There's so many different theories about how whiteness is packaged in order to make it more palatable. Yeah. You can, we can, yeah. I think we'll just. I just want to make I just want to make this one. That this idea of bias, but the person who wanted to talk about bias isn't here. Unconscious bias. That there is a real, we would still carry on saying it's unconscious bias, that racism and sexism and all the others, but actually they're conscious. So that idea of unconscious bias is another way of fluffing up and softening the idea that we're racist. Most of us know that there's racism, right? We know that there's something bad going on. And so we know that. So why is it that we cannot deal with it? All right, so that's the question we should be asking. And that Charles Mills is from the Critical Race Scholarship, and he says white ignorance. So it's an ignorance. It's not really a fluffy dog. It's a resisting, it resists, it fights you all the way. It fights back, it's militant. You know, there are guns and bombs involved in racism. In Northern Territory intervention, tanks. It's not, you know, it's an ignorance that's active. It's not just sitting there waiting to be it's dynamic, it refuses to go quietly. We've seen the terror attacks, right? Bombs, we're talking big, horrible stuff here. And it's not confined to the illiterate. We will find, again and again, working class people and the people in the flats at Manal was third world people, I'm from the third world, we get along, do you know? We actually go to each other's houses and festivals and we get along. So it's not the illiterate, the uneducated, but the highest levels of the land. So I just think, and it's unblushingly, it says that this is knowledge. So we're talking about university. Most courses in race, most research is funded by white people at the top. Not Indigenous people. They should be the ones who are saying what racism is. Is it? Isn't it? You know. So that, for me, that idea of unconscious bias, which is aimed at this gentleman, is about that it's actually, it's better to call it willful ignorance. And that this is a James Baldwin quote. He's saying, and he's sort of suggesting that people can't face the fact that Australia is racist. They can't believe that we would do that. So because of that, we have to deny race. So I just changed Australia to America to Australia, and I just wondered if you think that rings true. So it's really important to think about recognition as symbolic recognition or material, right? Where's the money that goes behind it? So symbolic is usually used as a substitute. Oh, we're going to say sorry, but we're not going to give your land back. You know, we're going to say we respect everybody, but in reality, only three types of races come into this club or... You know, what we talk about here is saying it versus doing it. And so saying something is a very powerful tool that allows you not to do it.
Or having one iftar a year and having different delegations from different organisations and saying, we're diverse, we're multicultural, we've had an iftar. But there's no time to talk, there's no time. It's like eat and keynote speakers, white keynote speakers. And it's done, and that's it, and that's their multicultural.
And the rest of the year, you're competing for funding, right? Like, we get money. Why is white, pretty much white? Aboriginal Family Violence Service didn't get money this year. The legal services. So, but we get funded loads because, you know, and I'm just thinking, how can we, you know, divest of some of that and share some of those resources? So white privilege, and then Manal's just going to talk to you about I'm just going to send this to you because I'd like you to just... Yeah, so Manal, could you just talk about the patterns? Any comments, first of all? Any comments about that? Sorry, I've been talking too much. Any comments or... Concepts, yeah. Metaphors,
yeah.
Brilliant. Yeah. A bit of theory is so important. It can make you feel all the things I've been feeling all these years. It's true.
Yeah.
And it's actually a proper theory and it's actually been written about and it's not just me.
It's not just me, that's the thing. Am I going crazy? Is it that gaslighting stuff? Is it just in my head? Am I super sensitive? But now it's like, oh my God, so many people have experienced something similar. And it's a system,
not the individual. And that's really empowering for us, people of colour, but it should be also empowering for white people. Right, Manal, sorry, darling.
No, that's okay. Yeah, just reflecting on clients coming through the door and just being very conscious and aware of how hard it is, how courageous it is for them to actually come through our doors and literally be at our mercy to some extent, yeah? Those feelings that are coming up for them and just being in tune and thinking, trying to put ourselves in their shoes and really listen. Just listen and validate their experience, their feeling. That can open so many doors and it doesn't take long. It could take a couple of minutes. Really doesn't take long to build that connection. To change their experience. I was just going to follow through with what Nilmini has so beautifully articulated as usual. I always learn so much from these spaces, honestly, always growing. And I go home and I think about it, 3 days of reflection. I think, oh, all these Betty drops. Anyway, I wanted to share with you some common white patterns that obscure and protect racism. One is racial segregation and isolation. People expecting people of colour to educate, but we have to have the proper tone and proper mannerisms and make white people comfortable in the process. For example, the way Yasmin, what's her name? Yasmin Abdul Majid, when she spoke, obviously it put a lot of people out. Because she didn't say it the way they expected, or she wasn't supposed to say it at all. But if a white person said it, and there's so many have, nothing happened to them. Lack of understanding about what racism is. Seeing ourselves as individuals outside of racial socialization. Lack of racial humility, unwillingness to listen, unwillingness to trust or seek the perspective of people of color. Lack of authentic interest or ability to sustain engagement. Believing we can be exempt from the power of racial socialization. Wanting to jump over the hard personal work and get to solutions. Needing to maintain white solidarity, save our face, look good. The good / bad binary and focus on intentions over impact. Like really, does intention matter? When it comes to racism. The question is not, did racism take place? But rather, how did racism manifest itself in this situation? And some of reflective questions could be, how am I noticing whiteness manifest in our workplace? What is welcoming, affirming, and inviting for white people here? What about our institution? How does it look white? How do white people in our institution come together and maintain white solidarity? What accommodations are made for white people's feelings about addressing racism? All of these are things we think about, and sometimes we think, how friendly is our organisation? Sometimes when we did that census exercise, we can get the details of our suburb, of our locality from the ABS, from the census information, and see what our locality, what demographics are our locality made of? Who's accessing our service? Are we catering for the needs of our people? Has anyone in the organisation done that research? How can we make our organisation a little bit more friendly? You know, posters, this and that. I wanted to find a fostering. Something fell in my lap and I wanted to find something about foster care for my community. I opened up a few organisations that are local and all I saw were white bodies. I thought my community is not going to relate to that. I paid for my ticket and I went to Sydney because I opened up one organisation that had a diverse range of bodies in it, and I thought they're going to know what I want, they're going to know what I want to talk about. And because I'm so old-fashioned, I can't get on the phone. I've got to be sitting in front of a person and speak to them so I can read the whole body language. So I took my own personal money, took a plane to Sydney, met with the CEO and sat down and had a conversation. We don't realise, we underestimate that welcome feeling that we can do on an individual level and an organisational level to someone coming through the door. And word of mouth speaks volumes. Mm. We just walked in, when we walked into this building, Naomi and I, there was a little party going on downstairs in the room. We walked past it, I just looked at Naomi and I go, we can see power in that room already. One person on their own, obviously a person of colour standing on their own, a group of other people standing and talking and laughing, one was observing. And it's just interesting that when the veil's lifted, how much more conscious you are. And I guess that's what also builds empathy and that ability to relate, because you've somehow gone through it yourself, you've experienced it yourself. So you're just more in tune and you can't put the blinkers back on. It's almost like it's the Matrix. No, you can't unsee it. You know, once you know, it's almost like, I wish I took the red pill instead of the blue pill. oh, why did I take the movie? Sorry, Dolly.
No, it's all good. That's great. Look, we're just going to finish up now, but I want to return back to your cases. But this is a really interesting map, right? I developed it for another research project. These are the kind of typical services one victim survivor of family violence would have to encounter. There's a lot, right? And we're all there. All of us are there. And so what we're needing to think about more is that person in the middle, is actually, there's a lot of diversity in that person in the middle. So we're just going another layer, yeah? So just, and to think about intersectionality is where power relations meet, right? So that, and it's not just one size fits all, this homogenous, who is usually imagined as white, as middle class, you know, everything's made around that one central dominant imagined subject or consumer or citizen or whatever. So that's just a visual that I think, and I think it surprised me even when I made it, how many people they have to. So every possibility of harm can happen at every one of those engagements. So what we're talking about is what Manal is saying. Can we at each stage look at it? Just look at how it is they're coming into that service. Are you allowing them to inhabit that category? You know, you're saying, okay, Vietnamese people have mental health issues. They need post-recovery support, but they're doing nothing to allow them to inhabit that category that they've created that is actually beneficial for everyone. So that's exclusion. Yeah. So, I'm sorry to cut it so short, but we just have to finish. But that was an amazing session, everybody. Thank you for your contribution. And I hope you found it useful. But I've given you this article. What we tried to focus on today was the two things, practice and theory, and to do with culture. So I hope that you finished with it thinking about differently about culture and the power that's embedded in different kinds of culture, and also looking. So we talked this intersectionality, the practice when you come to the culturally and linguistically diverse, it's much more complex than your ethnic identity. So we have unpacked a lot of that, more just to think differently and unlearn some of our biases and prejudices. One of the articles that Manal gave you, I thought it would be better to read it after we've done the training or the session. And it's a critical race, you know, approach, and she's in Sydney, and it's a very interesting article, I think, that will probably bring together a lot of the themes that were going on today.